Hi, this is Steve Hopkins, and this is Pong Now, an interview series talking to some of the best players and personalities in table tennis. Today I have Paralympian Jensen Van Imburg with me. How you doing, Jensen?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you, Steve?
I'm doing well. So I said when we were getting started, usually I am talking to very seasoned players, old guys like me, and we sit around and we tell stories about stuff that happened in the good old days. I'm not used to talking to somebody in their prime like you, so I think this is going to sound a little more standard interview style, but don't let that stop you. If you've got cool stories to tell, say I've got a story about that and lead us in a different direction, all right?
Sure.
All right, so I want to start by congratulating you. I know 2020 has not been ideal for some of where folks were planning on going and some of the way things were supposed to work out. The USOPC has named Olympians for 2021, so it's not like you have to, rerun through all of these steps again. You are on that Paralympic team. You're going to be in Tokyo. You just have to figure out what to do with your nervous energy for the next year.
Yes, for sure. I've had so many plans for this year, and to have them, I was even in San Antonio for about 17 days getting ready, preparing for tournaments in May to lead up to Tokyo. So, and then we had to scratch all that and I had to come back to Florida, and it's just been really a crazy year, but you just got to be positive, and kind of keep going and looking forward to what is going to happen.
Have you managed to get to play? Do you have a table in your house? Do you have some place where you can go and practice?
Well, luckily for me, Florida, they've been like opening so many things. So I've been able to train with my coach here, Gary Fryman. I've been doing some lessons with him 3-4 times a week, and then going and playing with the players that do show up that come and play, because not everyone is showing up, but it's good training to kind of keep my level and not go down.
All right, so we'll get to your level in a little bit, but let's back up. Since we're doing this interview style, I'm not sure that everybody in our table tennis community knows who you are. So let's start. Tell me how well. All right, so let me just be blunt. What is the disability that puts you on the Paralympic team?
Okay, so I've spinal cord injury from my armpits down, which means that I can't feel anything from armpits down, and obviously I can't use my legs. So I have my arms, my hands, and some of my shoulders and some of my back, but that's about it.
All right, and you play in a wheelchair?
Yeah, in a wheelchair, yeah.
Which class are you?
I'm disability class 3.
All right, and in class 3, is everybody in a wheelchair?
Yes, everyone's in a wheelchair, and it ranges from, there is a big range, which I like a lot because it gives you kind of different types of styles, but I think it's a very strong class.
All right, and I said this when we were kind of prepping a little bit at the beginning too, for a lot of us who just kind of selfishly go to tournaments and play and have a good time, we might see one wheelchair player at a big event. We're not normally making it over to the wheelchair events and watching all of the different levels. Describe what a match looks like, and I'll probably play some videos and stuff for folks to see a little bit as well, but give me an idea of what this all feels like.
Well, for wheelchair table tennis, which I play, is that it's very tactical. It's not more you push and then you open like an able body. You serve, push, somebody opens, and then you go into the rally. For wheelchair, it's more tactical. You want to exploit your opponent's disability and try to find that ball that you can knock off the side, or get your opponent out of position, or get the ball, place the ball perfectly. So not more about power, but more about tactic and more placement against your opponent.
So, all right. So again, I keep finding myself thinking through questions. You got to be careful not to offend sometimes, and apologies for some bluntness.
Oh, it's okay.
You said just a minute ago, you said, so exploiting the disability. So if you had somebody who couldn't reach left, you would hit balls left. If you have somebody who can't lean forward, you would hit short balls or balls that go off the side. I saw a video that you had posted that you said a friend had created for you. It had an Eminem song in the background. And several of the big shots that you hit were very close to the net, heavy angle, and off the side where the other player had no shot at that. Is that a little tactic for you?
Yeah, I like to do the angle shots. You know, it's like if a guy has trouble reaching short to the backhand, then that would be the strategy, is to go short to the backhand. Or if the guy doesn't like the ball deep to the backhand, and then you play it there, but you got to mix it up. So you have to try to find your opponent's weaknesses and where they don't like to play the ball, and kind of use that to your advantage and exploit it.
All right. And services have to be long?
They have to be, they can be short as long as they're moving forward and it stays between the two corners on the table. So it can be short, it can be long. As long when it's short, as long as it goes, keeps moving forward.
All right. So it could bounce twice or more, but ultimately somebody doesn't touch it. It has to roll off the end of the table. Is that right?
Yes. Yes. Correct.
And I should ask you what your weakness is, but I don't want to screw anything up. So, all right. When did you start playing? When did you start with table tennis?
I started when I was like 9 years old. I was at my brother's tennis tournament because he plays tennis for Oklahoma University. I started there. They had a table there and there was a bunch of kids playing. Well, I guess I could call it ping pong. I was playing there because, you know, they didn't have the rubbers. It's just regular wood rackets or whatever. And I was playing and I got really good. I was beating like all the kids there. So I'm like, oh, maybe I can do something with this. And we got a table at my house, and it really just, everything came from there.
And how about coaches and other players that you watched? Did you develop on your own, or did you find the right combination and build that way?
You know, I looked at a lot of matches from the top class three players, and I copied some of their serves, some of their forehands, some of their backhands, and then I added some of my own twists to it. And for sure, my coaches that I've had in the past and I have now have helped me a lot too. Gary Freiman and Vlad Farkas that I just have just started working with about a year ago. So it's been a good mixture.
And when you find a coach, is the coach for table tennis in general, or is the coach kind of a specialist?
For Gary, he was kind of just a coach in general, and he started learning about the para game and kind of adapting to it. And then with Vlad Farkas, that I'm also working with, he worked with the Romanian Paralympic team. So he knew already about the wheelchair game and all that. So it was good to have him. Then he didn't have to restudy everything like Gary had to.
All right. So when did you make the jump from being a good player to being one of the top players?
When I made that jump, I think it was last year in March, I started really finding my way and figuring out my game. But really what was like the biggest jump is when I played in October of last year in China, where I had the best tournament of my career, and it actually qualified me for the Paralympics. So that was about October of last year was where I went from good to a very high level player.
All right. And so let's see, like logistics. do you have a table tennis chair that you use just for events, or is that not important to you?
Right now I don't, but a lot of players do have one just for table tennis. But I've for sure, I think sometime in my career after Tokyo, I will be getting a chair just for table tennis, because I don't want to change now, but I for sure will get one.
And how many countries have you played in now?
It's been a lot, you know, it's probably about like 10, I think. It's been all over Europe, a little bit of the Americas, and then one time in China. So it's great to travel.
All right, so we'll circle back where we started. You said, so you've been practicing, which has been able to help you stay at your level. How would you describe your level?
My level right now?
Yeah.
My level right now is probably around, like, for people in the USA, I'll probably say around like a lower 2000 right now, because I'm not training so much. But when I'm really playing well and training full time, I'll probably be around 2050, 2075. So it's a little lower now, but I still feel that once I am training, I'll be back there.
Do you think standard USATT ratings are the right way to judge level for a Paralympian, or should we be more focused on what your ranking is within, you know, your class?
I mean, sometimes it is a good way to measure it, but for like some disability classes, it just depends on the disability class, because like class one, you can't really measure because they're so disabled. So you go off the world ranking, but for like the less disabled classes, then they can really start competing against actual able-bodied players, and then you can kind of see what's your level at. But you can use both, you know. It's good to use both. But I think the most important is the world ranking.
And what is your world ranking?
Currently, my world ranking is 11, but the highest I've been to is 9. And I'm the number one junior of all wheelchair classes. So from class one to class five, I'm the number one.
All right. So you've got 1 year. Do you have to make it into the top four to have a legitimate chance? Or like the Olympics, will some of those people ahead of you kind of be positioned out because of limits from different countries?
For me, I think the best thing to give my best chance for like seedings and draws and stuff, I think top eight, if I can get to top eight or top seven, then I can get like a better draw. But for me, I'm not even worried about that. You know, it's my first Paralympics. I'm going to go in there, give my all. I have no pressure. All those guys that played it so many times have all their pressure that they're expected, you know, to do well and to win. And they've never seen me compete at a tournament like that. So I know that if I use my game and I'm healthy and I'm ready on that day, I think I can do very well.
I started by saying I normally talk to old guys. How old do you think most of the players are that you compete with on average?
I think they're around in their 30s or 40s, you know. I do meet a few guys that are in their 20s. And their teens are, it's very rare to see some teens, but for sure, late 20s, 30s, 40s, sometimes 50s. There's even a guy that plays, and I think he's like 60 years old or something. It's crazy. It's a lifetime sport.
So if you set out and win two tournaments a year, you're going to have a whole nother room for all your trophies for your next 30 years, right? What's next for you? So what do you think once things are pretty much back to normal, what's a normal work week gonna be for you getting ready for the Olympics, for the Paralympics?
I think I will be back in San Antonio training with Vlad Farkas and be training there, and then making a trip to Europe here and there to train with other wheelchair players to get that kind of, because it's so much different playing wheelchair to able body. We'll get that wheelchair practice in and play against different styles. But mainly I'll be in San Antonio and then here and there in Europe.
Where do you stay in San Antonio?
I stay with a friend that he's a class two, actually. He hasn't played much internationally, but his name is Gabriel Diaz de Leon. So I stay in his house, which I'm very lucky to be able to stay there. And he gives a room for me, and I just train almost every day.
How about physical side of things? You do weights and stuff like that too?
I took a break, but I like to work on my shoulders and to do weights with my shoulders and a bit of my arms. But mostly I've been started recently swimming, which is very good for the cardio.
How about nutrition? You have to eat a particular way when you're in training?
For me, like, I'm the most picky eater in this whole world. I don't eat that great. So, like, for me, I like to cut back when I do start training. I like to cut back on the calories. So I will stop drinking soda and less burgers and more like chicken and steak and rice. So I wouldn't say I have like an athlete diet, but it's better when I'm training than when I'm not training.
All right. So where were you when you found out that you had qualified? So you did that through competition in China, or was that an announcement of some sort?
Well, I kind of had a feeling after how well I did and I saw the world ranking. They take like top 14. So when I moved myself up to 19, I'm like, okay, I mean, there's going to be a few tournaments left. I don't think anybody will be able to get so many points to pass me and boot me out, you know. So at that point, I felt like I qualified, but recently they just announced it, and I think it was like a week ago, where they made it official, which I was very excited and happy about it.
Who told you? Where did you see it?
I was, I woke up, and because they said on that, I think it was June 30th, I think it was, or something like that. They said that there was going to be an announcement on that day. I didn't know what announcement it was. So I just went right when I woke up, I went to ipttc.org and looked at it, and it was that. And it was a very good thing to wake up to.
And who did you tell first?
I think I told my dad first. I woke up and he walked in my room and I told him, and he was so, so pumped for me. Yeah.
I think we're all pumped for you, man. So, all right, let's see here. I also saw when I was looking up stuff that you had a GoFundMe page that's out there. What are you soliciting funds for? What are you fundraising for?
All right. So for the GoFundMe raising, it raised money for, my lessons with my coaches that I pay them for each hour, my travel expenses that I have to cover for my mom to travel with me. So we have to pay for my mom to travel with me wherever we go until I can for sure be fully independent on my own. And yeah, that's about it. You know, the coaching, travel expenses. And yeah.
So how much do you need to raise in order to make this this whole venture affordable for you?
I think around like 10,000, 10 to 20,000 for this year would make it comfortable. So my parents wouldn't have to use much of their money.
Do you know the date as to when you're going to be heading to Tokyo next year? Have you thought that far ahead?
They said something like August 24th or 25th, but I like to, you know, keep it day by day and see what's going on, because, you know, anything can change.
How about how many tournaments do you think you need to play between now and then in order to be at your peak? So COVID-19 aside, what's your tournament plan for these next 13 months?
I would like to play 3 or 4 tournaments just because it's been so long since I've played a tournament. It's been since October of 2019.
That 3 or 4 over the next year, or is that trying to play 3 or 4 each month? You're looking at like spread out major tournaments over a full year, right?
I think 3 or 4 tournaments before Tokyo.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when you say 3 or 4, are you looking at U.S. Open, U.S. Nationals, or are you looking at, you know, going to German Open or Spain Open or something like that?
I'm looking at those, you know. Next year, there's supposed to be, it's supposedly that they're holding Polish Open in March again, and also I think Italian Open. And then also then in May of next year, they always have Slovenian and Slovakian Open. So those are the ones I've been looking at, but it all, you know, anything can change with this situation. So just kind of just planning it by year.
Well, when I put this interview up, I will go back and pull some of the highlights of you winning events and hitting those angled shots. I think there's even a few of you growing up, so folks can see what you look like as a at least as I remember, a little pudgy kid returning some balls. But this is probably a pretty good place to stop. You know, it's nice to hear a voice and not just somebody that I'm tapping keystrokes back and forth at. You've got a really cool personality, a great smile. You're going to be a great representative of the United States. And as you said, man, you got 40 more years or so to keep honing and developing a game. You know, there's really no ceiling for you at this point. It's going to be really exciting to watch the arc of your career.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks a lot for being with me here on Pong Now, okay?
Thank you for having me.